So I feel like I've known you for years and years and years and watched your career as both visual artist and stellar, amazing fashion photographers and product creators and videographers, and it's been so interesting to see you kind of modulate from one genre to the other so evenly, and I would love to talk to you about that, but I thought we could start at the beginning. You're both Dutch, I think both from Amsterdam, and I think you met there.
Yes, we did.
Having worked in fashion and art, so maybe you could just tell everyone how you met and how you started working together.
We met in school. We were both at the Fashion Academy in Amsterdam in 1984.
She walked in and I saw her walking into the building. I was like, what is that?
And I think we just saw each other, and but we didn't really make any contact that much. But then I left to go to the Rietveld Academy.
And Inez was 21, I was 23, so I was way too young for Inez.
At that time. But I left to go to the Rietveld Academy to do photography because I figured out that I couldn't handle the sewing machine and everything else that came with fashion design. And by that time, you had already started your own line. Straight out of school?
Yeah, I started straight out of school. I wanted to start my own company. And I was looking for somebody who could help me visualize the images. And somebody remembered, remember that girl, Inez Valencia. I said, of course I remember her. And I called her and I invited her to come over and to explain what I was doing. And she said, yes, let's work together.
Yeah, so from 1986 onwards, we've been working together, and we fell in love immediately. But I had a boyfriend, and he had a girlfriend, and it took 6 years to sort of align our love lives. And
It was great because we kept
working together. We fought. We hated each other. We didn't speak for a year. You know, the usual stuff. And so we worked through all that stuff already before we actually started going out. And now we're together, married. We have a son who's 12. And
now we work 30 years together.
Yeah, 30 years already.
And at what point, I know you came to New York fairly early, and you were at PS1 in residency. Did you decide consciously that you were going to take one path to be visual artists, or because I remember seeing the Thank You Thymaster,
yeah.
I think was the first body of artwork.
Yeah.
Or was it always a kind of free flow between your commercial practice, and I don't say that in a derogatory sense, and art practice?
I think at that time, I had just graduated from the Rietveld Academy, and we were asked to be at PS1 as artists in residence, and I didn't really understand what it meant. I think we spent, in Holland you get a stipend to be the artist in residence at PS1, and they give you a house and money for a year, and it felt very strange for both of us to kind of be here and not really be part of the system, because you're kind of part of PS1, but I had just come from the Rietveld Academy, and I didn't feel like being in another school system and in that idea. So we were kind of looking around and trying to figure out what New York was and how...
And we thought New York was so old and ugly.
Yeah, we really were thinking this is not for us. We couldn't sort of put our feet here, and we watched a lot of TV. We were extremely lonely, and because everyone we met was sort of saying, "So what do you do?"
And we said nothing.
Yeah, we said we're not doing anything, and it just felt. And so everyone's like,
we watched TV.
Great. And then they would turn away from you at dinner, and so all we did was watch TV and.
And read books.
Read books and look at exhibitions. And in one hand, we tried to make contact with record labels and magazines and agents to to say, oh, look at us, we're doing portraiture, fashion, art. And at the same time, we were required to do this show at PS1, and which we made all the work for it in Holland because we were so homesick. We went back and made the work there. And
also because in Holland we had all the facilities, had all the computers and all the stuff.
Yeah, because we started working
and,
with
and
the computer.
At PS1 we only had a studio with a broken window and a pigeon flying around, so we're like, oh, we can't do anything here.
It was just a very strange, we weren't really thinking about anything really. It just was, you know, the work, the Thank You Thighmaster series was very much a commentary on what we saw in America, you know. So it, you know, for us it was really about, wow, all this striving for perfection, all this idea of, you know, the perfect body, plastic surgery, but what use is your body if everything goes through, all contact is no longer physical, it's all through the internet or computers and fax machines in those days, phone sex, etc. So we try to make sense of it all, but it was not meant that much for us as like a choice to be in the art world, because at the same time we tried to work for magazines and have an agent, and it always kind of went hand in hand. We never really set out to have this sort of parallel career that we have.
But at the same time, we really, from the beginning, we wanted to be independent from the art world, from the fashion world, from anything we were doing. So I think that was also the reason.
Yeah, we decided we can't be too much in one world or the other. We felt the freedom to sort of let the work find the context and let the work find the venue was more interesting to us. And also the idea of what context means for an image and how people look at an image once it's in a magazine, once it's on a gallery wall, what it says in the captions. You know, we've always said, like, when any picture, I mean, if I would credit the clothes, it would be a fashion picture, and if I would say the name of the person on it, it would be a portrait, and if it would have some Lucite title, it would be a piece of art. So it just sort of, we were interested in playing with that and with how the work just is the work from two brains and two people, and it ends up somewhere.
Is the collaboration any different? I read a quote, I think about your fashion photography, and it may refer to both, where I think, Vinoodh, you said that Inez takes the picture and you steal the picture. So if you could address that, what that means in terms of your process of collaborating to render an image.
When we take pictures of our subject, then Inez is mostly the one who directs the talent. And I rather to be more the observer, so I walk around and steal the pictures. So they're not so aware. They don't look in my camera because they're busy looking in her camera. Mm-hmm.
So you're both shooting.
Yeah, we always shoot
angles
at the same time. And
you get a different energy.
Yeah, like there's this, you know, like he said, I'm usually the one directing the person in front of the lens, and so they look at my camera, but because they're really looking at something, when Vinoodh then takes a picture from a different angle, there's a real intent in the person's gaze, and it's not just me saying, oh, turn your head to the left or whatever, and it's just a very different feeling. And when Vinoodh started taking pictures as well, it just was such a great thing to see that we would have the same moment from two different perspectives, and that there was this, all of a sudden, this world of choices that, you know, one day for one specific project, it's all of Vinoodh's pictures, and for another it's all of mine, or it's a mix, and it doesn't really matter whose picture it is. It's just that there is all of a sudden so much more possible, and there's so much more freedom because of it. Because we both feel like if I don't have it, the other will.
What about the digital manipulation and work? I know certainly in the art practice, it's so extreme that that's almost the point because it's very, very present. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But of course, I would imagine in fashion that that's par for the course. Do you do that collaboratively as well, or is that something you have somebody else does that with you?
Well, there's operators that, you know, actually do the handwork.
Yeah, we started in the early 90s. We started on this machine, the paint box.
Mm-hmm. You were early.
We were very early. Yeah. Because we did, I think Inez did a tour with her school and to this lab, and they explained what they were doing, and it was mostly used for straightening cigarette packs and car and change colors of cars.
Yeah, so it was just used in the advertising world before, and we, you know, when I saw that happening and like what the possibilities were, and it just made this idea of sort of breaking through the surface somehow, and
through time, basically.
Yeah, like you don't have that decisive moment anymore. There, I mean, you've made the picture, but then you get a second chance. Like you can go in and alter it and sort of fuck with time. And it just was such an exciting first few years when we started experimenting with it that you know, all of a sudden there was a way to visualize something so internal, but on the surface. And it's always been a big fascination of us, and it still is. We still, of course, now every photograph is retouched, mm-hmm. and some to a large extent, and we try to not retouch too much and be as true as possible, or go completely the other way and
I think also we,
you know,
we
play with it.
To destroy the image in the computer. It was almost a sort of post-crunch in the computer to alter the image that it almost looks unfinished or raw and totally not perfect.
Yeah, and this idea of what is real and what is not real, and how do we look at things, how do we register images, and how do we judge bodies, and you know, all of that.
Another quote of yours, Vinoodh, about that all of your pictures are self-portraits, which I found really fascinating, and the fact also that you really you have included your own images and images of you together in your work.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if you subjected that to the same, those pictures to the same kind of, you said, destruction or manipulation.
Yeah, I think every picture we take is a self-portrait.
Perfect.
Especially.
Can you speak
louder, please? Sure. I think every picture we take is a self-portrait. It's always this, how we feel that day, how we feel ourselves in the world at that moment, and
it's also this projection of yourself on someone else. That is, whether it's a portrait or whether it's a fashion image or any of the images we make, there is this strong idea of projection. And there are some works in here that were really based on that idea, where it was purely about the exercise of just behind the camera and in front of the camera and just the lens in between, and what would you get back if you just completely try to get all your energy onto the other person and see what comes back. And that's generally the case with any picture we take. And it's this sort of awareness of the exchange that is interesting to us. And in that sense, I think it's there's a lot that you in one way give of yourself in order to get something back of the other that reminds you of yourself. And in that sense, we see it all as a self-portrait, because it's...
And most of the pictures we take, most of the time, in 15 minutes, because it's so
fast,
short,
yeah.
It's so fast.
It's a fast process.
People get bored, or you know, it's like...
It's
you have
usually
to be,
there within 5 minutes.
Or it gets too mannered in a way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How do you decide if you're both taking pictures of your subjects? What is the final image? How do you decide together?
You see it.
You know
it happens in front of you. And
you
then
feel
you,
it, yeah.
Yeah.
And do you ever
it's
have
there
disputes
and then it disappears.
About that, or is it really?
No, not really, no.
No, it, we
after
both
30
know
years
it.
Now.
But not even in the beginning.
Not even now.
You just know it. It's something, and a lot of people ask us, like, how do you know when you have it?
It's intuitive.
Yeah, it's intuitive. You just feel it. You know when everything is in the right place and when the emotion is right, or and you know, it's
mostly
also
it's the first picture or the last picture. It's always
usually. It's usually that. But then a lot of times, you know, when you later see all the images from one series again and you go back in and you think, oh, that one was great too, and that one's great too, and now it's not so great. It kind of, you know, if that picture that you chose wasn't there, then you would have chosen another one. Mm-hmm. So it's, but again, you just, it's purely feeling, and a lot of actually what we do is so much based on something that you can't really put your fingers to, and I think especially with the fashion stuff that we do, it's so much about the language of clothes and how you use these codes that everyone seems to be able to read in order to convey something about the life of the person that you're talking about. Like, and all that gets projected onto a model, and then, you know, through clothes, through hair and makeup, through styling. I mean, we work with big teams, and it's such a collaborative thing. It's never really us saying, like, no, it's like this. It's a true collaborative situation, and it's all about what are we saying with a white shoe, or why? What are we saying with, you know, a short nail versus a long nail? I mean, all these tiny little differences make up the language of mm-hmm. an image for us.
Mm-hmm. It's like reading a face, basically.
Yeah.
And is it the same with your celebrity photographs?
Yeah.
You have the same kind of.
Yeah. Effect. Yeah. I mean, with celebrities, like, you tend to have very little time. And so what's great is that it's a very intense relationship for 15 minutes, and you have to get to the bottom of someone mm-hmm. really fast. And so we never take much time to
had to we get prepare ourselves really well, and then the moment we do it, we improvise.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's because someone comes in, and you think, like, oh, you know, this person is like this. For instance, once we photographed Ben Kingsley, and we thought, Gandhi. We're going to have Gandhi in the studio.
Mistake.
And that was not the case. He is, I would say, the opposite of Gandhi. And he didn't, like, we had thought of him, like, with, like, splatters on his face of, like, a constellation of, like, celestial
and spiritual,
you know,
person.
Spiritual. And he looked at us, I'm going out. I'm out of this studio now. And he was like, you're crazy. I've been to the gym. I broke my hand. You can't shoot this hand.
He wanted to be a sexy beast. So.
And yeah, he had just done Sexy Beast. So he was very much like that. And so it was a very different person. And then you have to go, like, okay, fine. No constellation on your face. You know, you just say, okay, which hand can we use? Okay, we can use this hand. Okay, put it here. Boom. Photograph. Bye. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's how it goes.
So, time for one more quick question. You're a collaborative duo, but you also, as you mentioned, collaborate, but also with, like, MM, another duo.
MM Paris,
Paris. The choreographer,
Stephen.
Certainly people like Bjork, who come back again and again to work with you.
Gaga.
Common language. Maybe you could just comment on that. As a pair, does that play into strengthen your bond, or is it? Does you feel like it somehow?
We think it's refreshing, and it's very. It opens our minds, and
I mean,
it's very important to work.
I mean, it doesn't really affect us. It actually makes all that we do so much better and more interesting. And we each have a different relationship with the other collaborators, so
But there is always the base is always trust. Like, with all these people you just mentioned, there is never a no. If somebody says, oh, I want to do this, then Bjork's like, okay, let's do this. Or there's never like, oh, no, I'm not into this, or I don't want to do this.
Yeah, that's, I think, is the true base of a collaboration is that there is no no. That it's always a yes, let's try it. Let's try it, and together, you know, you get to that point where it's the thing you were looking for. Whether, and it's usually the thing you didn't know you were looking for when you started out. And that's the beauty of collaborating.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you.